بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي ونسلم على رسوله الكريم أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I hope you can hear me. I'm assuming you can, inshallah. So we will begin. We're slightly late today. I apologize. I was just getting my laptop started. I do apologize. We're into lesson number two. Today what I want to talk about is briefly just summarize and add some of the comments that I made last week, and then move on very, very quickly to the story of Adam and Eve, Adam and Hawa alayhi salatu salam. I'm aware we talked about this last week. We broached the subject last week, but I want to go into more detail, inshallah. What I will also do is when I go into the story of Adam and Eve, I will give you the references as they are in the Quran. The reason for that is you can make a note of them, and in your own time, you can read them, share them with your children, with your colleagues, and so forth and so on. Very, very important that we engage and read the Quran, right? We need to know exactly what the Quran is saying when it comes to these sort of topics. So it's very, very important to bear this in mind, bismillahi ta'ala. First thing I mentioned last week was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He talks about men and women, He never talks about them separately. He talks about them in a unity, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not only address men, but He also addresses women. So even when He does address a particular woman, even when He does mention a particular man, for example, that's just the example, but the moral is equivalent and applicable to all of us. That's very, very important to bear in mind as well. The second point I emphasized upon was we need to know our basic faith and our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very well. Who are we? Who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He is our creator. We are the created. We are His slave. And we do exactly what He tells us to do. And He is not asked about what He does. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not asked. La yus'alu amma yaf'al. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not asked about what He does. Wa hum yas'alun. But we will be asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is very, very important to bear in mind as well. The third point, which was important, that men and women in Islam, in the religion of Islam, men and women are both equal partners when it comes to access to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. Okay, they are both Allah's creation equally, and they both need Him. So there's no hierarchy in the sense that for a woman, for example, to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be forgiven, she has to go through her husband. There's none of this in Islam. It doesn't exist in our faith as well. So they are both equal in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. And then I briefly talked about the forbidden tree, which I will go back to today, inshallah. So these are some of the points that I mentioned last week. What I want to do now is just briefly go into the story of the wife of the Prophet Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, his wife Hawa, or also translated to Eve. Okay, so the Quran speaks of Adam and his wife in many, many surahs. It's scattered all over the Quran, but in each instance the story has a particular focus. So whenever you look in the Quran, sometimes it feels like, why is Allah mentioning Hawa here, and then He mentions her later on here, or He mentions Adam here, or any other story, right? The reason is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Allah is fitting that story in with a particular narrative that He wants to get across. So He borrows from different stories, or He brings in different stories, or parts of different stories to tell us a message. And sometimes He'll tell an entire story, like in the story of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Okay? So the Quran, for example, does not mention Adam alayhi salam's wife by name. She's not mentioned by name. And I'm telling you as the Quran tells you. This is what the Quran tells you. And I will, inshallah, give you references as we go through, so you can make a note of them and read them in your own time as well. Bismillahi ta'ala. So she's not mentioned by name, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nor does He mention how or indicate how she was created. So we don't actually know from the Quran. I'm not talking about hadith here. I'm just talking about the Quran itself. We don't actually know how she was created. And the nature of the Quran is such that it only tells you what you need to know. Right? People then get into all the details, but this is what the Quran says. Okay? Now, of the five Quranic accounts related to Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, the woman appears in three of them, and in all three, the emphasis of the narrative, of the story, lies with the disobedience of human towards God. Not woman towards God. Not man towards God, but human towards God. And the forbidden tree, and then Shaitan's guile of how he tried to fool them. But it's not Hawa's fault. That's very, very important to bear in mind. We mentioned this last week as well. Okay, because obviously, if you say it's her fault, then throughout human history, then people can justify all sorts of nasty things towards women. And I'm not just saying this because there's sisters sitting in their room or listening. I'm saying that this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. Right? And that's very, very important to bear in mind. Hence, my whole theory here, my whole theology here is based on the Quran itself, because it's the strongest form of evidence. Okay? So, by contrast, the remaining two accounts, in other words, from the five, the remaining two accounts, do not mention the woman focus on Iblis, Shaitan, and Iblis's disobedience and rebellion. But if it doesn't mention the woman, but focuses on Iblis, and it focuses on his disobedience and rebellion. So she only comes, out of the five accounts of Adam alayhi salam and the husband and the wife, she comes in three of them. Okay, taken together, the Quranic accounts of the events involving the creation of Adam alayhi salam and the rebellion of Iblis indicate that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam from clay or from sounding clay, from mud, and then he molded him into a shape. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam, from some sort of clay structure. You'll find this in Surah 15 verse 26, Surah 38 verse 71. You'll find this there as well, okay? Then the Quran also mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fashioned Adam with his hands, subhanallah. Right? That's something very, very powerful. Allah created Adam, Allah created human, the first prototype, with his own hands. We don't know how what that means, right? We don't take the literal meaning. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam. In other words, he created us with his own hands. And this is in Surah 38, verse 75. You'll find this there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him in due proportion. And then Allah breathed into him his spirit. وَنُفِخَ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِهِ The divine spirit was blown into us, and it's always been in us. Right, that's how our children in the womb come alive. When the angel comes, and then the life is given to the child in the womb. This is mentioned, for example, in Surah 15, verse 29, Surah 38, verse 72. Okay, thus, while we are created from matter, so we are created from dust, essentially, and that's something to bear in mind. Adam alayhi salam's nature also includes a divine breath, subhanAllah. So you might be a lowly form of dust, but you have something that's much more stronger than that, which is Allah's breath in you, so to speak. Okay? A spark, if you like, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted to human beings to the exception of everyone else. Yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not given this to anybody else. We are created from dust, yet we have the divine breath breathed into us, subhanAllah. That makes us special as well. Okay? So this higher nature and confers our dignity. If Allah breathes His soul, His breath into you, that shows that you are something special. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ We have endowed you, we have blessed you. So you are all, every single one of us is a special creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also mentioned in the Quran that the purpose in Adam's creation was to make him what? A khalifa. His vicegerent. His deputy on this earth. Okay, that's in Surah 2, verse number 30. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that this is your duty. You have a duty on this earth to look after the earth. Right? So beyond our discussions around ibadat and fiqh of ibadat, beyond our discussions about mundane other issues, we should also be concerned about deforestation, for example. We should also be concerned about plastic being dumped in the sea. We should also be concerned about how much we recycle, how we look after the earth, right? The pollution. All of this is part of our responsibility towards this earth. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this responsibility. You'll find this, like I said, in Surah number 2, verse number 30. And Allah also gave him what? He also gave us knowledge concerning the nature of things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us the name of things. Surah number 2, verse number 31. The following verse, Allah mentions this, I taught you this. So we've been given the ability to seek knowledge, to understand things, the intellect, which is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some ulama even go to say, and the Quran also alludes towards this, that our knowledge is above that of the angels. How much more do you want me to tell you about the greatness of the human being? And you'll find this in verse number 2, Surah number 2, verse number 32 to 33. Just read it, you'll find it all there. Okay? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then what did He do? He commanded the angels to prostrate themselves before Adam alayhi salatu salam. Right, as to show the greatness and the nobility of the creation of the humankind or human species in Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. But it was only Iblis who refused to acknowledge the human superiority. Right, and he said, "I am something special." He says in the Quran, what does he say? Why should I do sajda to this creation created from dust? And it's interesting that the I, this thing I, ana, is something that's something that the Quran looks down upon, ascribing greatness to yourself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَلَا تُزَكُّ أَنفُسَكُمْ. Don't praise yourself too much. Don't think of yourself as something special. And when you look at Fir'aun, he said, أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى. I am the great Lord. أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى. And Iblis, what did he say? أَسْجُدُ لِمَنْ خَلَقْتَ تِينَ. Should I do such sidda? Should I do sidda to something that's created from dust? So you see this in something that we, it's all about me, the selfishness in the human creation. Right? It's all about my needs. وَكَارَ الْإِنسَانُ عَجُولًا. Allah mentions in Surah Al-Anbiya that the insan is created ajul. He wants things done very, very quickly. She wants done things very, very quickly. وَكَارَ الْإِنسَانُ عَجُولًا. So shaitan refused to prostrate before Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. We don't need to go into debate about whether you can do sijda before a human being. That's something that's for some other time, inshallah. But we know now it's haram to do sijda before anything besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This was ahkam before Islam came along and superseded all of these things. Okay? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cursed and banished Iblis, but He gave him some time until the day of Qiyamah. And so he has become our enemy. He actually vowed, he actually made a promise to tempt and assault all humankind, okay, except those who are strong and who can withstand him. And you'll find in many places in the Quran, Allah constantly reminds us of what He promised, what He would do, what He's going to continue doing until the end of time. Verse 15, Surah 15, verse 34 to 43. The whole conversation is there. Surah 38, verse 77 to 85. Surah number 7, verse 13 to 18. Surah number 7, 13 to 18. In the same surah, number 7, 26 to 27. So Allah is constantly telling us about our arch enemy. Okay? So he is in an antagonistic relationship with us. In other words, he doesn't want us to succeed. Okay, he is an anti-man force, if you like. Right? He doesn't want us to succeed. Okay, and so he is going to take us from morality to sin. And this is why this discussion around gender and all of these things are very, very important, because this is one of the mechanisms that he's using to take us away from Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, to take away from that primordial creation of Adam and Hawa alayhi salatu wasalam. He wants to make things more complicated, to confuse us. But the Quran is saying, if you read the Quran with an objective mind, with an open mind, put all your presuppositions in mind, this to one side, inshallah, this will all become clear for you, bismillah ta'ala. Okay? In the second half of the Quranic story, which tells of the human disobedience to God. So we've talked about Iblis a little bit, right, from the Quran, but we also get another story, which is the human disobedience to God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the story is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala banished and told Adam and Hawa alayhi salatu wasalam to leave Jannah. Okay, for a short period of time. This is when Hawa alayhi salam comes into the story. Not because of the banishment itself, but just because she comes into the story now. She's not mentioned earlier in the story, but now she comes into the story. Okay, Adam's wife is first mentioned as Adam's partner in Allah's injunction when he says, live in this garden. So Allah mentions them both about living in this garden and eat fruit freely from his fruits. Allah says, eat freely from his bountiful fruits, but do not approach this tree. وَلَا تَقَرَّبَا هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ. Both of you, don't go near this tree. This is a test in Jannah, but it applies to us today. Allah has made this world a means of us to plow for our akhirah. But there are a few things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made haram for us in this world, right, as a means of test. But you will get the recompense for that in so also in akhirah. One of the brothers here was asking me just before we started about alcohol, that alcohol is haram in this world. But we know the Quran tells us what? That in Jannah, you'll have alcohol. Sharab and tahura, but not the smelly one, not the one that makes you drunk, makes you do silly things, pure alcohol. So Allah is telling us, you'll get all of that in the Akhirah. Allah will remove all the negative effects of it, and it will only be goodness and piety and purity in it for us in the Akhirah. So all of these things Allah has reserved for us. But Allah says to them, do not approach this tree. Surah number 7, verse 19, Surah number 2, verse number 35. Two places Allah mentions this. And in Surah number 20, Allah relates that it was Adam to whom God addressed the warning that Iblis was his wife's and his wife's enemy. Okay? That it was Adam to whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that he's your enemy and your wife's enemy. Okay? It is also to Adam that Shaitan then whispered his temptation concerning the tree of eternal life and everlasting kingdom. This is what he risked. وَلَا تَقْرَبَ هَذِي الشَّجْرَةَ فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ فَأَزَلَّهُمَ الشَّيْطَانُ فَأَخْرَجَهُمَا مِمَّا كَانَا فِيهِ. Right? The tree of eternal life and everlasting kingdom. This is in Surah number 20, verse 120. Okay? Shaitan whispered to them twain. Twain means he whispered to both of them. Okay? So here we see what? It's not her fault. It's not his fault. He whispered to both of them. Remember my point last week about the dual form in Arabic. Okay? In order to reveal to them their private parts, and said, your Lord only forbade you this tree, lest you become angels. So he lied to them. Okay? And said that your Lord only, so you become angels or you get eternal life. Okay? And he swore to them, I am indeed your sincere advisor. Subhanallah. Shaitan said to them, so you need to know who your friends are. You need to know who your advisors are. Who do you seek mashwara from? From whom do you seek counsel from? Your friends are very, very important. Okay? And he caused their fall with deception. So he deceived them. Just like today, many of us, unfortunately, we are deceived in many, many ways. So this is something that's a test for us in this dunya as well. And when Adam and his wife both ate from the tree, as the Quran mentions, Surah 7, verse 20 to 22, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions also in verse 20, Surah 20, verse 121, and Surah 7 and verse 22, he mentions that they both ate from the tree and they perceived that their private parts, they saw their private parts became uncovered. They perceived their private parts. Sawatuhuma, and shame overcame them for the first time. So this human idea of shame came. Some people say that they weren't covered at all initially because they were never like that. But now they became that human element came into them because they disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here. And so they sued their together leaves from the garden to cover themselves. So even though they might have been naked in Jannah, it wasn't like how we are over-sexualized today, like we find it somehow abhorrent. They were so pure, they never saw each other in that way. They never looked at each other's private parts in that way, subhanAllah. This is the purity of human beings, right? So anyway, Iblis was a cause of their expulsion from Jannah. This is the most important part for us here so far. It was Iblis who was a cause of their expulsion from Jannah. Verse number 36, Surah number 2, you'll find this there. So it wasn't Hawa alayhi salam's fault. It was not never Eve's alayhi salam's fault as well, okay? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose Adam and he forgave them as well. So we also learn there's no concept of original sin. Allah forgave them both as well. Surah 2, the second surah, also adds that Adam alayhi salatu wasalam received words from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yani inspiration from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah forgave them. Okay? And he promised them freedom from fear and grief to all human beings who heed the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we follow the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we follow what the Quran says, we submit to the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the teachings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will be guided. It's as simple as that. Through the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you'll find this in Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah number 2, verse 38. Okay, this is the narrative, okay? Now, the dynamics of the narrative proceed from a focus on Adam to one involving Adam and his wife. So it starts off talking about Adam himself, and then the Quran moves. So in Surah 20, you'll find it's only about Adam, his creation. So when you move to Surah number 7, and I've done all the work for you, so you don't need to look into all of this in detail. Surah 20 to number 7, it moves. Okay, it moves from Adam to his wife. Okay, so it proceeds from Adam to his wife, his spouse. The final version of the story, however, transcends both of them. Okay, it also talks about other things. So it's not about gender here. Can you see so far? The Quran doesn't talk about gender. Quran doesn't blame the male or the female, saying one is superior, one is inferior, it's her fault, it's his fault. There is none of this narrative in the Quran. These are things that people read into the Quran. They bring this to the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not talking about this. What is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually talking about? And we get into this detail now. Okay? So it talks about notions around our khilafah. That we have a responsibility on earth. We are Allah's vicegerents. We are deputies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah has brought us here. We're here to stay for a short while. We will be asked about what we did with our time in this world. How did we bring up our children? How did we make sure that we fulfill the rights of other people, of fellow human beings? All of these things are part of the narrative Adam and Hawa alayhi salatu wasalam. Higher knowledge, right? The knowledge, the ability that we are not meant to waste our time sitting in front of the TV and just watching programs which have no benefit to our salvation. We are meant to be people who are seeking higher realms of knowledge, asking the bigger questions, reading books, learning knowledge, pushing our children to become scholars and ulama and alima and alims and so forth. These are the people that we should be aspiring towards. Okay? So these are things that Allah wants from us. Also, spirituality, focusing on making ourselves better human beings, to elevate ourselves above the angels, just like the angels were prostrating before Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. We need to become such that we are elevated towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and those who heed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's guidance. So these are some of the bigger stories, what we call a meta-narrative of the Qur'an. Right? There is no gender here. The talks we've called of last, the topic we've called woman and gender in the Qur'an, right? That's only to kind of invite people to come, to tempt people to come, yani, like the tempting of the fruit of in the apple tree that was, or the tree, the fruit that was in Jannah, that was just to tempt people. Halak, in reality, the Quran doesn't talk about gender in that way, right? Yes, it transcends gender in many ways. It's talking, it's addressed to males and females, right? So sometimes I say to people that men are just, if not more important for them to attend this gathering as well. Alhamdulillah, we have some, but it's more important for men to listen to this as well, just as it's important for sisters. So nobody should think that this talk is only for the sisters. Okay? And alongside that, it's a misnomer. It's a misunderstanding when people take certain stories about women in the Quran. I might as well mention this while we're at it. Some people take certain stories of women in the Quran to say, oh, this only applies to women. And somehow the whole topic is about women and that particular bimari, that it only applies to women. No, the Quran doesn't talk about that. That's a misunderstanding of the Quran. All these diseases, all these spiritual maladies apply just to men, just as much they apply to women. And that's something very, very important to bear in mind as well. So a lot of people unwittingly have bought into this narrative that this is only for women because it's mentioned about someone's, a prophet's wife, or this is only about men because it's mentioned about this particular man. No, it's mentioned, it's addressing all humankind. This is very, very important to bear in mind as well. Okay, so she appears, Hawa alayhi salatu wasalam, as a participant in the events of repentance and banishment. Right? That's how Hawa Islam gradually becomes part of the story. But the gender question, like I've said, I want to emphasize this because it's a big issue. The gender question only remains a mere detail in the Quran. It's just a mere detail. Yani, it doesn't even matter, right? It doesn't even matter that she's a female and he's a male. It doesn't make a deal because there's a bigger story to be told. And the reason this is so important is when people read the Quran with gender in mind, that's what they're going to come out with. But if they read the Quran for hidayah, if they read the Quran to get guidance, to be inspired, to be motivated, to learn lessons, they will come out with a lot more. This is very, very important to bear in mind as well, okay? So it's a mere detail that bears no importance for the whole story, okay? In the end, the main theme has shifted away from it altogether to the issue of mankind's purpose on earth and the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's guidance. That's the most important thing. The story is what? That you've been given responsibility. You are mukallaf. Allah's given you intellect, Allah's given you bodily organs, Allah's given you physical capacity. How you use it, you will be asked about this. This is the most important thing. And you are duty bound to find guidance, male and female. Allah's not interested in gender here. Subhanallah. This is very, very important to bear in mind, okay? Later on, this theme about guidance and our purpose on earth is also expanded when you look at the Madani verses of the Quran. So if you look at Surah 33, from verse 72-73, you also see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the what's called the primeval covenant, alast. That the idea that before all of us were born, all our souls were gathered before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, alastu bi rabbikum. Allah asks all of humankind, am I not your Lord? Qalu bala shahidna an taqulu yawm al-qiyamati inna kunna an hadha ghafilin. Everyone testified to the existence and the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? So again, the narrative is what? Obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the most important thing. That's what the Quran is really emphasizing. Okay? And so Allah talks about this idea where He offered this trust, this amana, to be the Khalifa, to take on the burden to the heavens and the earth and the mountains. But they all refused this burden and were afraid of it. But the human undertook this responsibility to look after the cosmos, to look after the earth, to look after nature, to look after, to provide justice, to provide security, etc., etc., etc. All these responsibilities. And so he took on this responsibility. Okay? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also declares that humans, male and female, are free and equal agents. Okay? And so this is something to bear in mind as well. And Adam and his wives slip or error that happened in Jannah was called a zalla. فَأَزَلَّهُمَا الشَّيْطَانِ Shaitan caused them to slip. We call it a slip and an error. Did not, and this is really important. Again, there's a number of points I want to make today that are really fundamental. Did not result in a lasting defect of the human nature. In other words, just because they made an error in Jannah, a small error in Jannah, doesn't mean that we are all responsible for it. Doesn't mean that that's a permanent feature of the human existence. Yeah? And we were only sent to this earth to live for a short time. Allah said, you've only come here for a short time. What's our destination? Back to Jannah. We're here for a short, if you like, a holiday. Probably not the best place to go on holiday if you're living in Jannah. To come down to earth. But Allah says, you've come here for a short time. Allah mentions this in Surah number 7, verse number 24. Surah number 2, verse number 36. Okay? And so there was no burden of the curse of the original sin, unlike Christianity. I've mentioned this before last week as well. Okay? So man and women may be weak and lagging. They may be proud and ungrateful. But the Quran judges neither as lost to forgiveness. Right? We're not lost to Allah's forgiveness as long as we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are some important facets of the story of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam and Hawa alayhi salatu wasalam. In the last 5 or 10 minutes or 15 minutes, I just want to summarize a few key points. So that's the narrative of the story. And I've given you references so you can relate and reflect back on what I've just mentioned, inshallah. And this will keep you firm in terms of understanding what the story of Adam and Hawa alayhi salatu wasalam is telling us. Okay, bismillah, a few things I just want to mention as well in addition. That when we approach the Quran, just to remind us, when we approach the Quran or Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we need to move away from any preconceived notions we might have. Right? If we come to the Quran with liberal values or conservative understanding of Quran, that's what we're going to take from the Quran. Okay? If we have a mindset which is all about being very liberal, then we'll interpret the Quran in a very liberal way. If we have a conservative mindset, then we'll find conservative things in the Quran or in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we'll take those as to weaponize and to attack other people. But that's not what we should be doing. What we should be doing is approaching the Quran and Sunnah as a means of guidance. Right? I'm approaching this because I'm in need. I'm muhtaj. Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ وَنَحْنُ الْفُقَرَاءُ. That we are in need. So when we approach the Quran, we approach it in a way that we want Allah to open it up for us. We want Allah to open up guidance for us. This is why in every rakat and every namaz, every salah, we recite Suratul Fatiha. Why Fatiha? Fataha, to open. We're asking Allah to open it up for us. Whether that's in salah, whether that's in zikr, whatever else it may be as well. Okay? So remember the framework of creator and creation. If a person has this framework in mind, then everything else becomes very, very easy. So you don't even need to go into fiqh. In our modern Muslim culture, when we approach Islam, we approach it through a very fiqhi mindset. Right? You know, like very fiqhi mindset. Halal, haram, makruh, wajib, all of these things. They're important. Nobody's denying them. So when a person approaches the Quran for a fiqhi mindset, what happens is that they miss out some of the important fundamentals of the Quran. For example, in the Quran mentions Surah An-Nisa about inheritance, for example. Right? There's a whole surah about women, and a woman, a sister reads it and says, well, in the Quran, the husband or the male gets twice, the brother gets double what the female gets. That's not fair, right? Because you're approaching the Quran for a fiqhi mindset. What you need to do is approach the Quran for an aqidah mindset first. What are the usools? Allah decides, I am his servant, and he tells me what to do as a believer. This is what we do. Once a person submits to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then all of this becomes superfluous. Yani it's something that not as important. By the way, this idea that it's unfair, for why we're just quickly touching upon it. In reality, when you do the maths, because there's more factors considered in the inheritance shares, the sister or sometimes comes out better off as well, depending on who's alive at the time as well. So it's not, you don't take the Quran face value like this as well, okay? I can show you through calculations where actually sometimes you can come out better off as well. But the idea is we submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the most important thing. So besides doing the fiqh, what we need to do is submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. So when a person understands the Quran, we need to try and understand it the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam understood it, the way the Sahaba understood it. Right? Because we are prisoners of the modern world. When we approach the Qur'an, we approach it through gender, we approach it through feminism, وغيره وغيره. But the Sahaba never approached it that way. They opened the Qur'an, they read the Qur'an, they experienced the Qur'an genderless. For them, it was what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and this is for our guidance. Okay, but in the modern world, because this has become a very topical issue, people approach the Qur'an through this. Okay, so this is very, very important to bear in mind as well. So if you approach the Qur'an with varying intentions, you'll come with different conclusions. If you come to the Qur'an with a mindset to find out, you know, that it's somehow a Qur'an that preaches against women, na'udhu billahi min zalik, or it's against men even, right? Then that's the interpretation you're going to come out with. Those are the conclusions that you're going to come out with. And so this is something to bear in mind. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Qur'an, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ, we have revealed in the Qur'an what? مَا هُوَ الشِّفَى, a healing for you. You're sick, Allah is telling you. You are sick. مَا هُوَ الشِّفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَى, there's healing for you in the Qur'an, and there's mercy in the Qur'an. Right? This is a means of healing and mercy for the Qur'an. It's not meant to cause friction. It's not meant to cause confusion. It's meant to heal the soul. It's meant to heal people that are struggling. Okay, so when we understand this, then it becomes very, very, very easy to appreciate the Qur'an as well. Okay, so the other thing we don't want to do when we approach the Qur'an is we come to the Qur'an with an open mind. We don't come to the Qur'an to seek validation for what I believe. This is what I believe. For example, a male might say, I believe that I'm superior to my wife, so I'm now going to look into the Qur'an and find justification for that. If a person comes with this mindset, they'll find this in the Qur'an. But if a person comes to the Qur'an and says, you know what, I want to find what Allah actually says in the Qur'an. What does my Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say in the Qur'an? Because I want to understand it for myself. Then that person will come out with a much more deep understanding. I say this because a lot of people make their mind up what they want, and then they look for it in the Qur'an. They fish in the Qur'an. Right? We approach the Qur'an with an open mind. Allah, what does Allah want from me? What does the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he seek to achieve? This is very, very important to bear in mind. So one of them is self-rectification. Right? And most important thing is, like the doctor would tell you, that if you go to the doctor and the doctor says, you know, you've got this disease, you need to go on a cancer treatment, I need to report you straight away and we need to get you treated. If a person says, no, there's nothing wrong with me, I'm fine, and you leave me alone, I'm fine, don't worry. Is the person going to be cured? Never. The Quran says you need to know first that you're sick. You need to know that you need cure, right? Your heart is sick. Once you realize that, then you'll find much more in the Quran. You'll find a cure for the Quran. But if you come to the Quran with an arrogant mindset, if we come to the Quran with, we've already got our presuppositions about the Quran, then it's like we come into the Quran sick and we're in denial. Then I don't need to get anything from the Quran. The Quran just needs to affirm what I believe. Does that make sense? It's very, very important to bear in mind as well. I want to conclude with just some, so we've talked about Adam and Eve today in detail, but I just want to conclude with a point that I made at the beginning, and inshallah end there. Now this is in Surah number 66. I really want you to do this. In fact, I would encourage everyone to do this tonight or when they go home, is open the Quran, go to Surah number 66, end of 28 Sipara, 28 Juz, go there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in verse 10, 11, 12, say something very, very fascinating, and I've touched upon this last week, and I'll give you this example so at least you can realize and you can appreciate the broader point that I'm making, which is what? That the Quran is not interested in gender. It's talking about spiritual diseases and maladies which are applicable to male and female. The Quran is also talking about positive traits that not only belong to males or females but belong to both of them, and they can both aspire towards. So let me give you an example. In verse number 10, Surah number 66, I encourage everybody to look at this, inshallah. Just look at this and look at the translation. Allah says, ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا امْرَأَةَ نُوحٍ وَامْرَأَةَ نُودٍ كَانَتَا تَحْتَ عَبْدَيْنِ مِنْ عِبَادِنَا صَالِحَيْنِ فَخَانَتَاهُمَا فَلَمْ يُغْنِيَا عَنْهُمَا مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا وَقِيلَ ادْخُلَا النَّارَ مَعَ الدَّاخِلِينَ. Allah presents the example of those who disbelieve. Allah presents the example of those who disbelieve. مَثَلَ لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُ. They are under two of our righteous servants. كَانَتَا تَحْتَ عَبْدَيْنِ. In other words, they were married to two of our righteous servants. Who are they? The wife of Nuh alayhi salatu salam and the wife of Lut alayhi salatu salam. Two women that are married to two prophets. So they say, Allah says, they were very pious prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَخَانَتَهُمَا They both betrayed them. In other words, the wife betrayed their husband. فَلَمْ يُغْنِيَ عَنْهُمَا This did not help them. فَقِيلَ ادْخُلَ النَّارَ مَعَ الدَّاخِلِينَ The Qur'an says that they were made to enter Jahannam because they betrayed the Prophet. Now a person reads this Qur'an, he comes or she comes with their presuppositions. Look, the Qur'an is practicing misogyny. What's it saying? That women are evil. نَعُوذِ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ Right? That, you know, the Qur'an presents these two women in a bad light. So therefore, khiyana, which is betrayal, is something that women do. نَعُوذِ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ I would say you've missed the entire point of the Qur'an. The Qur'an is not talking about them as women. The Qur'an is saying that these are two people who just happen to be women who did this. Let me address the point about them happening to be women in a minute. They both betrayed the husband. The Qur'an is not telling you that they were women. Just because they're women, they betrayed them. So it doesn't mean that women betray or practice betrayal. Men do it as well. But the Qur'an is saying that this is an example of people who disbelieve. Allah has given an example of those who are kuffar. That people who disbelieve always betray, male or female. So Allah is saying, don't betray one another. Whether you are male or female, it doesn't matter, don't betray one another. Of course, we still have the question that why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give the example of two females? But then look in the Quran, continue reading the Quran. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in the following verse? See, this is what people miss out. You have to read the Quran holistically. Like I said last time, when you approach the Quran, you have to read the entire Quran. Allah says something very beautiful. He brings two women again. Oh my God, He's bringing more women. And subhanAllah. But what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do this time? SubhanAllah. وَذَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِمْرَأَةَ فِرْعَوْنَ إِذْ قَالَتْ رَبِّ ابْنِ لِي عِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَنَجِّنِي مِنْ فِرْعَوْنَ وَعَمَلِهِ وَنَجِّنِي مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ That's one verse. Then the two women that were mentioned in one verse, Allah's only mentioned one woman in one verse. Then He brings another verse for another woman. وَمَرْيَمَ ابْنَةَ إِمْرَانَ الَّتِي أَحْصَنَتْ فَرْجَهَا فَنَفَخْنَا فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِنَا وَصَدَّقَتْ بِكَلِمَاتِ رَبِّهَا وَكُتُبِهِ وَكَانَتْ مِنَ الْقَانِتِينَ Then Allah says, He gives the first example. He brings two ayat for two women dedicated to them individually. Two verses dedicated one to each woman individually. Allah says, Allah presents the example of those who believe. It's genderless. And what example does He tell them, believing men and women? The example of a woman, the wife of Pharaoh. What does He say? When she said, because we know the story, and we'll cover the story inshallah next few weeks, about how she helped Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. When she was about to be killed, what dua does she make? Subhanallah. رَبِّ ابْنِ لِي عِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ Allah, make for me a house by you in Jannah, and save me from Fir'aun and his plans and machinations, and save me from those people who oppress one another. What's Allah talking about here? He's not talking about the fact that they were women. He's talking about the fact that, look, these are sifat that we should have, that we don't engage in oppression, we don't harm one another. These are the bigger messages the Quran is saying. Then Allah talks about Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. In the next verse, it's not in the same verse like it was in the verse before. Allah dedicates a separate verse for Maryam. Example of Mary, the daughter of Imran alayhi salatu wasalam, who guarded her chastity for men and for female. This is a story, that's what Quran is telling us. Guard yourself. وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا Allah says elsewhere in the Quran. Right? So protect yourself. So we blew into her garment through our angel, and she believed in the words of Allah and His scriptures, and was devoutly obedient. Yeah? وَكَانَتْ مِنَ الْقَانِتِينَ So if a person reads the Qur'an, they will come with, if they read the Qur'an with an open mind, they will say, Allah is teaching me some important lessons here. Which is what? Don't betray people. Don't betray the messages of God. Don't stand in the way of religion. Become people who serve religion. Become people who hold up justice. Become people who guard their chastity. Become people who are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you look at the Qur'an without a gender, right? If you look at without a lens of gender, you come out of all these spiritual learnings. If a person comes to the Quran with a mindset, they will say, oh look, you know, I've come to the Quran because I want him to affirm my belief that the Quran practices misogyny. So therefore, look at this verse number 10 in number 66 surah, is proving what I said. completely ignore the next verse, completely ignore the next verse after this, right? They miss the bigger picture. This is not about gender. This is about getting into Jannah. This is about guidance. This is about learning lessons. This is what the Quran is saying. And once we have these principles in mind, inshallah, we will, bi-iznillahi ta'ala, acquire salvation. I hope this is very, very clear. I hope I've made my points very, very clear. We'll end here, bi-iznillahi ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. The Quran looks at this from the point of iman and kufr. Not from the iman of man and woman. Not from the perspective of man and woman. From the perspective of iman and kufr. So certain women or certain people might appear successful in this world, but in reality they've lost. But some people might look like losers, but in the akhirah they have been successful as well. This is for those who believe. Okay, so the Quran is always talking about the akhirah. This is the great message the Quran wants to derive from. Not interested about male, female, all this stuff. Quran's not interested really. It's about getting you to Jannah, where we came from. Okay, so this is something to bear in mind. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all Jannah. Remember, both men and women are role models for both the groups. Final point, final sentence really here. That both men and women serve as role models for two groups, believers and unbelievers. Does that make sense? Men and women serve as role models in the Quran for two groups. Not male and female groups, but believers and unbelievers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our iman, give us understanding. Listen to these bayans, pass it on to your children, pass it on to your colleagues. This is very, very important usools and principles that we're trying to derive to help us stay firm in these challenging times. Inshallah, we will remain firm. We have nothing to fear. We don't preach hatred. We don't preach any form of harm towards anyone. We are only affirming what we believe. Throughout my lecture, last 40 minutes and last week, all I've been trying to do is telling you what we believe as Muslims. I'm not interested in what they believe and defending ourselves from other people. I am telling you what is Quran saying and what is it that we believe. And this is the first thing you always do. First thing when you get into any conversation about these sort of things is tell people what you believe. What's your position? And make your position very, very clear. Make it transparent and be honest about it. And the Quran tells us to be just. That doesn't mean we hate anyone. What it means is we are making our position very clear so people know where we come from. People understand where we come from. Right? Because otherwise people won't know our position. We're just arguing and shouting over at one another, but we're not having a dialogue. Right? And this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala seeks from us. May Allah protect our iman, inshallah. Barakallahu feek. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.